Joining us next on the line is Ann Coulter. She's the author of In Trump We Trust, E Pluribus Awesome, and she joins the Howie Carr Show every Monday. Ann, thank you very much for being with us here today.
Absolutely. Good to talk to you, Steve. Beverly Hills is in Los Angeles, not Florida.
Oh, you're in Beverly Hills. I'm sorry. I just assumed that you were down in Florida because it looked sunny and warm. I know where Beverly Hills is, Ann. So what do you make now? You've had a little bit of time to process the firing of Andrew McCabe. Is Jeff Sessions redeemed in your eyes, or is he still failing President Trump?
I never thought he was failing. I thought people were being crazy, and I've been annoyed with Trump for harassing the one person who agrees with the Trump agenda in his entire administration, Jeff Sessions. I mean, for one thing, even if Sessions were doing something wrong, he's the president. Fire him. You don't troll him on Twitter and just attack him. But point two, what he seems to be in his tweets, he, the president, so upset with Jeff Sessions for is allowing Rosenstein to appoint a special counsel. And although I agree a special counsel is a complete disaster, it's a star chamber, it always has been, and particularly this highly politicized special counsel, Trump brought that on himself when he went on the Lester Holt show after this whole big charade of getting Rosenstein and Sessions to write a letter recommending that Comey be fired for how he behaved during the campaign, saying Hillary was not under investigation, and then she was under investigation. Remember, we had a whole letter on it, but then the president couldn't resist going on Lester Holt and saying, oh, yeah, it was my idea. I did it because of Russia. Bam!
Yeah,
special
exactly.
counsel.
And, you know, if he'd have fired him on day one just as a matter of, you know, changing, you know, cleaning house, then we wouldn't even have a special counsel. Do you agree?
Yes, and also, I mean, I don't think it was appropriate in any event. I agree with that, but Sessions recusing himself from anything having to do with the campaign, he wasn't exactly, you know, showing up at every rally. He was at the rallies in Alabama. He was a working, active United States senator, but he was the first senator, but the first prominent Republican to endorse Trump. So yeah, he was technically in theory part of the campaign, and it does make some sense if there's anything being investigated pertaining to the campaign season that the Attorney General should recuse himself from that. Probably never should have hired Rosenstein, not because Rosenstein is necessarily so terrible, but he's just another swamp creature. And as I've said before, there are plenty of very impressive lawyers from very impressive law schools and impressive resumes who do not live in Washington, D.C. And I think that's what you want to be filling up your administration with when you have everyone living in Washington, D.C. trying to take you down. You know, Trump, one way or another, is going to be gone in a few years. The swamp is there forever. They're going to have to face their fellow swamp creatures. So, you know, who are you going to, whose good opinion are you worried about?
Well, speaking of hiring new lawyers, Ann, Joe DeGeneva is a frequent guest here on the Howie Carr Show, frequent commenter on different news programs. And there are reports out now that Trump has hired Joe DeGeneva. What do you make of that?
Probably a good idea. I don't really know what for. I like Joe DeGeneva a lot. Probably a good idea, but I can't really say anything more than that other than that I like Joe.
All right. And before we had you on the program, I was getting into the conflict between McCabe's statement, of course, this long, victimhood statement about how he's being targeted by Trump, yada, 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 partisanship. But in it, he says that there's a line in there where he says that any interactions he had with media, i.e. leaks, were known to James Comey at the time. And this is interesting because James Comey in congressional testimony under oath said that he never authorized any leaking to media. So have you paid attention to that? Do you think that James Comey is in any jeopardy potentially here?
The leaking to the press, I mean, that may be technically what he is, McCabe and or Comey. Obviously, Comey is leaking like a sieve. I mean, he released that memo through his friend, the Columbia law professor.
Who's now his lawyer, attorney-client privilege, thank you.
Right. That doesn't interest me as much as the fact that McCabe's wife got, what was it,
$700,000 from Terry McAuliffe.
Terry McAuliffe, a close friend of Hillary Clinton's. $700,000 is a lot of money.
For a state
Senate? That's a lot of money.
Think about that. What is it? What do you think a state Senate race in Virginia pays? I mean, that $700,000, that's what you would spend on some congressional races back, you know, just a few years ago. That's a crazy amount of money. But then they say, Ann, well, I mean, that money didn't come from the Clintons.
Well, it came from their best friend.
Exactly. You know, their longtime money man.
Give me a break. That looks like bribery. It certainly is the appearance of a conflict. And McCabe, as well as Rosenstein, signed warrants based on that ridiculous Russian dossier, the one with the golden shower produced by that nut Christopher Steele, and they signed warrants for FISA, for secret spying on an American citizen, this hapless schlub Carter Page. Those things are actually really bad deep state back scratching apparent bribery. That I'm more concerned with than technical violations and leaking to the press.
Yeah, and it's interesting, Ann, at this time, we're talking with Ann Coulter. She's the author of In Trump We Trust, E Pluribus Awesome. And there was a poll that was released just recently, a Monmouth University poll, and they actually questioned people, surveyed people on the idea of the deep state, and a bipartisan majority of people are concerned, finally, about an administrative state. I feel like Alexis de Tocqueville is kind of celebrating here in his grave that people are finally coming to know that there's this giant bureaucratic entity in Washington, D.C. that influences policy in some instances more than elected officials do. Did you see that poll?
Yes. No, I did not see the poll, but I think it's hard to avoid that conclusion. I mean, as I've mentioned before, one of the strange things is that the deep state was listening to presidential or I think he was still in the transition then, advisor Michael Flynn. He had what Flynn was gone after for by the special counsel, there is no underlying crime. He had a conversation with the Russian ambassador, as he should have. Obama would have said, you should have a conversation with the Russian ambassador. He said nothing that was inappropriate. Why was that phone call being listened to by the FBI? And then why was Flynn asked about it? What they ended up charging Michael Flynn with was lying to an FBI officer or agent about that conversation. There was nothing criminal about the conversation, but they're claiming that whatever he said about it to the FBI was not accurate. And how did they know? Because they were listening. That's crazy. We don't have a constitution that puts the law enforcement branch of the executive or law enforcement province of the executive branch above the executive branch. But that's the way it's operating.
Yeah, no, I mean, I don't know if you can technically call it entrapment, but it's pretty clear that they're out there fishing for, fishing for a case to make against Mike Flynn. And we learned last week that Judge Contreras, who initially accepted Mike Flynn's guilty plea, is actually really good friends with Peter Strzok and Lisa Page, and the text messages that were at first redacted showed that they were talking about how to leverage that friendship in order to, accomplish this, politically motivated campaign against a Trump aide. I mean, talk about swampy, Ann. That's as swampy as it gets.
Yes, although I read through those texts, and I could go either way on giving them an innocent reading or a nefarious reading. I just think the fact that there was a FISA warrant issued without full information being given to the judges on the FISA court about Carter Page, and that is really intensive investigation. That's going back through, emails you've sent in the past. It's not like going forward, we're going to start watching what this guy is doing. Carter Page has been the beating heart of the Russian investigation all this time, and yet there seems to be very little connection between Trump and Carter Page, other than the fact that during the campaign, Trump had to blurt out someone as, some random people as his foreign policy advisors, because no one respectable in the foreign policy community, or at least respectable to themselves, would have anything to do with the Trump campaign. So the media is taunting him, oh, you don't have any foreign policy advisors. He had to come up with some names. It was quite obvious at the time what he was doing, just throwing out names, not people he particularly knew or was going to consult. I think Carter Page has admitted he's never had a meeting with Trump. But this is for the last 8 months until we found out that the FISA warrant was based on that sleazy Russian dossier. It was all Carter Page, Carter Page, Carter Page.
All right, Ann. Well, we appreciate you being with us here on the Howie Carr Show. Ann is the author of In Trump We Trust, E Pluribus Awesome. You can get it now on Amazon. Thanks a lot, Ann, for being here on the Howie Carr Show.
Good to talk to you, Steve. Bye-bye.